Alvarez for getting this prepared so quickly. But this is an important hearing. The purpose of today's hearing is to provide the Office of the Inspector General and the Bureau of State Audits an opportunity to present several of their recent reports on the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation to the legislature. These reports are all significant in part because they touch on various fiscal aspects of CDCR operations, including the costs associated with lawsuits that occur because the department doesn't comply with federal and state laws, and some concerns over lack of internal fiscal controls and failure to use data to effectively manage operations. While in some cases these costs may seem small relative to the size of CDCR's $9 billion budget, it is imperative that the committee and the legislature should perform its oversight duties, particularly in light of the ongoing budget woes and the comments by the governor yesterday in his State of the State address. In light of that, we should leave no stone unturned looking for ways to help CDCR reduce their costs. So I look forward to listening to the testimony. Ask the first panel to come forward. And that would be David Shaw from the Inspector General's office. No, we're going to do the LAO. Sorry, I'm jumping ahead of myself. It's Thursday. We want to go home. So, Paul, and I won't attempt your last name, Paul. Go ahead and do it for me. And this is the first panel. It's the purpose is to give us an overview, and then we'll go to the second panel. I apologize. It's all yours.
Paul Golaziski with the Legislative Analyst's Office. The subcommittee asked us here to provide a brief overview of CDCR's budget to put into context some of the specific issues that the Inspector General and the Bureau of State Audits will be discussing today. So first I'll give you a brief overview of CDCR's budget and talk about some of the changes that were enacted in 2009-10. And then I'm also going to talk a little bit about our projections for CDCR's budget for the next five fiscal years. As you probably recall, the enacted 2009-10 budget provided about $8.2 billion in general fund for CDCR. And as you know, CDCR has many different responsibilities and missions. About 80% of their budget goes towards operating adult prison facilities, about 10% towards adult parole and the Board of Parole hearings. About 5% towards juvenile operations, and the remaining 5% is for headquarters administration, local assistance, and various other miscellaneous programs. The 2009-10 budget assumed about $1.2 billion in savings from various policy actions intended to reduce the inmate and parole populations, as well as from certain other administrative and programmatic changes. For example, I won't go through, there were many, many changes, so I won't go through all of them, but I'll highlight some of the major ones that were enacted. Some of the savings that were designed to reduce the prison and parole population included reducing parole revocations to state prison. There were also substantial reductions to inmate rehabilitation programs, as you probably recall. And there were reductions to headquarters personnel and various other changes as well. In addition to these $1.2 billion in savings that was assumed in the budget, there was a separate and additional $230 million in savings assumed in the federal receiver's budget for inmate medical care. So altogether, there were $1.4 billion in savings assumed in the budget. Now, this past November, our office released our projections of CDCR's budget for the next five fiscal years. And for 2009-10, we are projecting that actual general fund expenditures for CDCR will be about $1.4 billion higher than what was included in the budget. And if you look over the next 5 years, assuming just current law and current policies, we're projecting that by the end of 5 years, CDCR's general fund budget will be increased by another $2 billion. And the main reasons for this spending growth, and again, I won't sort of go into too much detail about them. If you have specific questions, you can ask me. But the main reasons for the spending growth include certain savings not being achieved as planned in the budget due to a lack of policy changes to achieve these savings. As well as implementation delays, a lot of the policy changes that were made in the budget won't take effect till January this month, whereas they had assumed a July implementation date. In addition, there are continuing substantial deficiencies for inmate medical care in the budget, hundreds of millions of dollars each year that we project will continue. As well, certain federal stimulus funds and funding from a local government finance shift that had offset CDCR general fund expenditures will expire after this year, we're assuming. And in addition, sort of looking forward over the next few years, we're projecting that there will be significant increased costs associated with operating new prison beds that are scheduled to be built as part of AB 900 and other construction programs. And in addition to that, one other significant issue, as you probably know, is that there is a federal three-judge panel that had ruled last August that the state would have to come up with a plan to reduce the inmate population by about 40,000 inmates over a two-year period. Now, we don't know for sure if this will actually happen. The state is still appealing, but if it did, that would have the effect of likely decreasing general fund expenditures by several hundred millions of dollars. But we don't. It would depend on exactly what changes were implemented in order to estimate the savings. So that sort of gives you a high-level overview of CDCR's budget for 2009-10 and in the coming years, and hopefully gives you some context for some of the specific fiscal management issues that will be discussed today.
Senator Grady McLeod.
I know you had to choose from all the people here, but
it's not a lot of quantity, but the quality is very high.
Absolutely. Isn't it a little incongruous that that we say that we're going to save when many of the programs have been shifted or deleted, which would then really affect the outcome of more? If the inmates are not being taken care of, let's say we do rehabilitation and we cut those programs, in the end run, would we not then see even higher costs for those people coming back that are not even included in there because of what we've done as a whole?
With the reductions to the rehabilitation programs, we don't really assume in the budget that those programs will reduce the prison population by reducing recidivism. So when they were cut, what you're saying is true. It could have the effect of increasing recidivism and contributing to a higher population, but it's not in the budget. It's not tied together that way.
But it will be cost later on.
It's possible. It would depend largely on how the department is implementing those reductions. They're trying to implement them in a manner to the legislature had given them a set of guidelines on how to implement the reductions, and some of the guidelines were to prioritize evidence-based programs, to serve as many inmates and parolees as possible. So they are looking at new models in terms of how they deliver programs and trying to mitigate the impact of those reductions, but it's likely there will be some impact.
Well, having three sites near me, which used to be in my district, which are no longer in my district, but knowing the people that work with people, they see the short-sightedness of the state cutting programs, and there's no negating the fact that that we had to do it because of budgetary thing, but those people on the ground see that as costing the state in the long term.
Yeah, it's difficult just to put a dollar figure or a population figure on that. But
okay, in light of State of the State yesterday, I assume the LAOs, because it's not a new issue, about cost savings prospectively if you privatized a significant part of the department?
Yeah, we'll obviously be looking at the privatization issue in more detail. We have done a little bit of work in that area in the past, a while back, but we'll be looking at it in more detail.
And you'll be looking at the experience in other states when they've done that, both short-term and long-term.
Mm-hmm.
And just as intuitive, listening to the governor yesterday, and I'm beginning to share a little bit of this, although from different perspective, just the frustration of being able to try to manage the budget for anyone's sake, because you've got so many, you've got the federal courts, you've got so many requirements to do that. Has that contributed to the struggle to manage the budget? Both the department is trying to, we're trying to, the administration is trying to with us. It just seems so difficult in light of what you just said, the mitigating factors.
In terms of the federal...
There's not a lot of command control here when you've got lots of entities trying. And it's not just entities. It's all the various pressures.
Well, in CDCR, I mean, about, I'd say about 15-20% of their budget is controlled by the federal receiver, not directly controlled by the state. So that does make it a little more difficult, I think, for the state to manage the budget for that part, since it is under federal court supervision.
And not to jump ahead too far, but since you brought up evidence-based, as the last part of our hearing, we'll be talking about the inability to track and get consistent numbers in a variety of ways. So we've been talking more and more here about going to more an outcome-based budget overall for the state. You care to comment on that? I mean,
yeah, that was one of the difficulties during the May revise last year and during conference when the governor had proposed eliminating all of the inmate and parole rehabilitation programs. Is it was difficult for the legislature to really prioritize them because we don't have the outcome data that you're referring to. Now, the legislature has provided funding in the past couple of years for the department to improve its IT systems to track those sorts of measures. So hopefully moving forward, they will have that data, and the department is still working on it. It's difficult because not only do the inmates or the parolees have to go through the program, you have to wait a year or two or even three usually to look at the recidivism rates and to see if they are effective. So moving forward, hopefully we will have that data, but right now we don't.
Well, just my experience with outcome or performance-based budgeting, you have to develop the proper benchmarks, of course, but that depends on the criteria and the inputs. And ideally, you compare the department or the program over time versus certain goals you're trying to reach, and then against best practices compared to other comparable states. And it strikes me that's extremely hard to do when you can't get the numbers on things that would, just from a generalist, things like recidivism or the impact of a teacher who's been in a program for a long time and getting people their GED and getting them out and getting employed. So when you look at best practices in other similar situations or other states, what have our Blue Ribbon Commissions and others found from that? How do we get out of the position we're in to a better position?
And I think that's one of the things that the Bureau of State Audits found in their audit, too, is the lack of outcome data. I'm sure they'll be discussing
that. We'll get to that later. Anything else? Okay. Thank you. Great, as always. So now we'll go to the panel, the second panel. Apologize. That was our version of trying to help with health care costs. Get you a little exercise. Yuck, yuck. And this panel will discuss CDCR's payments to special masters and plaintiff's attorneys. We're going to start with David Shaw from the California Inspector General's Office, then Ben Rice, the General Counsel of the Department, and then Don Spector, Director of Prison Law Office. David.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman and Senator. Dave Shaw, the California Inspector General, and with me today is Jerry Toomey, who is the Chief of our Audits and Investigations Bureau, whose bureau actually created our report that we're going to discuss today. I appreciate the opportunity to be here today and discuss our report. I'm going to apologize in advance. My voice is coming and going with this cold that I have, but try not to infect my good friend here, Don Spector. We move along.
I have to wash my hands now.
I'm sure that will change during the course of this, this hearing. In the course of our work in monitoring Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation, we created this report. We'd actually begin collecting data on this about 2 years ago and watched it in connection with all of our other work with the department, and finally decided that we would bring forth the report. It's largely fiscal in nature. We've made recommendations, as you well know, within the report. We took notice of how much was going out to the special masters and to the plaintiff's attorneys over the course of our work with the department and working with plaintiffs and so on, and realized that there didn't seem to be a coordinated strategy with the department in making payments or monitoring the payments that were going out, and then also just in the significant increase in the amount of payments that were being made, where we started looking at this data a number of years ago, 97-98, we were at $2.4 million, and we were up to $16.2 million in 2008-2009. Just that significant increase, and part of that was due to new lawsuits that had been filed, and either the state lost or settled those. We thought that this would be an appropriate time to take a look at where the money was going and who was watching that. The objective and the scope of our review was to take a look at and publicly report on the 12 major class action suits, two of which that we've been involved with pretty closely at the Inspector General's office in the Madrid case and then also in Plata. So primarily focusing on the officer discipline system and in medical care. And there are a number of other cases that we haven't been directly involved in, but we work closely with the department to try to figure out where the money was going that were paid out. One of the things that we weren't able to track in this report was the amount of money that the department spends internally on its own attorneys. And there are a number of attorneys that work for the department, and that data was not available to us. That is something that I'm sure the department could comment on. Attorneys assigned to the Employment Advocacy and Prosecution Unit and other units within the department. So we tracked primarily the plaintiff's payments, those to special masters, and then the dollar amounts that went out to the Attorney General's office. One of the findings that we made is that there are no caps on the plaintiff's attorney rates in the state court cases like there are with federal cases. Under the Prison Litigation Reform Act, plaintiff's attorneys are limited to $177 an hour currently in federal court cases. However, that's not the case under state law, and being no caps, then the attorney's fees are set at the market rate, which vary and are significantly higher than what are paid in PLRA versus what the state would pay its own attorneys or the Attorney General's office. Monitoring costs on the lawsuits, the large class action suits, were $42 million, almost half of the total amount that was paid for costs in these cases. $31 million was paid in the Coleman case alone for mental health monitoring costs. It's a little unclear in the data that we looked at whether monitoring significantly helps the department achieve compliance. We couldn't draw whether from the data that we looked at whether or not the monitoring was increasing compliance. I would say that, and maybe I should have said this at the outset, that were there not significant deficiencies within the department, we wouldn't have the lawsuits and we wouldn't be making these payments. So and to that extent, and to the piece of this that we weren't able to look at, and that is the human costs of all this. Clearly, because of the large class action suits, the conditions in prisons for our inmates has gotten significantly better, especially in the area of medical care. That piece of it was beyond the scope of what we did. However, in trying to tie cause and effect together, the monitoring piece of it itself doesn't show that we're moving towards closing these cases out. Monitoring is sometimes performed by the plaintiff's attorneys, which might indicate why some of these cases have lasted as many years as they have. There would seem to be the plaintiff's attorney's bill for monitoring at the standard litigation rate, which I'm sure we'll hear there's a good reason for, but it would seem that the work performed in preparation for litigation or during litigation should be billed at a different rate than monitoring the actions, walking the prisons and talking to people. We found that there was a disconnect between The invoices that are submitted by the plaintiff's attorneys and the departments paying those invoices. There is no standardized invoice system or an electronic system which could identify errors and speed the department in paying the claims and also to identify error rates. Currently, the department will review the billings from the plaintiff's attorneys, although I would point out not to the special master since those payments go directly to the court. But this department has identified about a 4% error rate, and those are negotiated with plaintiff's counsels and then adjustments are made. However, the state is then billed for the time for the plaintiffs who negotiate and argue the bill. So at the end, the state ends up paying for those fees as well. Electronic billing on a standardized system would speed payments to the plaintiff's counsel and also, we believe, result in a cost savings. At the end of our review, we made several recommendations. The department should explore taking a look at supporting state legislation similar to the PLRA to cap plaintiff's fees in prison cases. The department should continue to work on an improved billing process to make sure that the plaintiffs do submit in their bills in a standardized electronic format. And the department should work with the courts to have independent monitors, where appropriate, follow the compliance and conduct the monitoring. And I'd be happy to take your questions.
We'll go through the whole panel and then come back for questions. So we'll go next to Ben Rice.
Thank you. Ben Rice, General Counsel at the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. Basically, in reviewing the report, and I can go through the three recommendations at the end, we don't have any significant disagreements with the Office of the Inspector General on the report. And in fact, if you'll see some of the recommendation, it talks about the department should further continue their efforts to do the following. I'll take each point one by one to let you know what the department thinks of it and how what we're doing to implement those suggestions. The first, again, is regarding the Prison Litigation Reform Act and seeking state legislation that would mimic what happens in the federal system. We agree with that. We are working towards to see if that can be accomplished, and if it can, then we'll submit proposals to further that legislation. In regards to seeking plaintiffs' bills in electronic format, again, we think there could be some savings there. We have made efforts to do so, and the Armstrong went so far as filing a motion to get those. It was partially successful. The court basically said, plaintiffs' counsel, you have to do this, but defendants, you have to pay for their systems because there's not just one law firm. It's not just the prison law office. There's Rosen, Bean, and Galvan, and in some of the cases, they have other larger private firms come and help them, and you have to then, you know, make all the systems work together, and you need to pay for that. And the cost-benefit analysis, we're still working with the Attorney General's office if we should push that further. The third recommendation is regarding the conflict of interest of having plaintiffs monitor the cases. I do think there certainly is a potential for a conflict there, and it certainly hurts a litigator in a litigation forum when the plaintiff's counsel can tell the court, well, this is what I saw when I was out there, and change the tone of a hearing. It certainly is a disadvantage, and it would be nicer in some areas. We do have independent monitors, and one of the steps the department has taken is that in several of these cases, we've gotten our own compliance team together to monitor, and in some cases have gotten the agreement of plaintiff's counsel to reduce their monitoring, such as in Valdivia and Armstrong, to do some of the cases together. And we've also worked at the prison law office on Perez and in Plata to combine those tours. So we've made some efforts to reduce things there. I would say that, as you started the hearing about leaving no stone unturned, and we were doing that, I would say, though, that I think our big goal in these cases and where you see really significant savings is to get rid of these cases. And we've made some efforts in those areas. The Lancaster class action was terminated. We filed motions in the Clark and the Gilmore class actions. In addition, everybody talked about at the beginning the cost of having the receiver run the medical side of CDCR. And we filed a motion to terminate the receiver. And in those cases, those are the areas where you'll really see significant savings, because monitoring is a big piece of this. And what happens is in these cases sometimes, and I think Mr. Spector will tell you, a lot of these billings sometimes are caused by defendants. They're the ones that started the lawsuit, and I mean they're the ones that didn't provide the care and that. And then later on, he'll tell you, well, some of the fees that have increased are because the motions we filed. But the truth is, sometimes you know you have to make a cost-benefit analysis of when it's time to stop, when we think the court's gone too far, and you try to take it back, because then you have these additional orders, and Armstrong is a great example. You have additional orders and orders and orders, and then you look at compliance in those orders, and they monitor that, and you'll go to a hearing, and they'll talk about, you won't talk about the ADA part of the case anymore. You'll talk about whether or not the folder was in the right place in the ADA's office, and you start losing fact of whether or not you were in compliance with the law. And it happens in some of these cases, and that's why I think it hasn't been a change in philosophy as much as you on a case-by-case basis look at these and say, it's time to fight. We think the court's gone too far. We think plaintiff's monitoring no longer helps. The report's the same every year or every visit. It's not helping us in compliance, and we should put our resources elsewhere.
Okay, thank you. That'll take us to Mr. Spector.
Thank you. Thank you. Donald Spector. I'm the director of the Prison Law Office. We're a nonprofit legal public interest law firm which has serves California prisoners for free and has done so since 1976. And as noted by my friend Mr. Shaw in his report, we are in counsel in the 12 major class action cases. The mission of our office is one mission, and that's to ensure that the conditions in our state correctional adult and juvenile facilities are humane and constitutional. And I want to respond to the report. It will come as no surprise that we disagree with much of it and believe it contains very significant factual errors that are details, but I will gladly go into in detail later if you'd like. But it should be a surprise that although the report comments on all of our cases and is critical of our motives and some of our practices, no one in the Inspector General's office called us or talked to us before the report was complete. The only notice I had of it was a call by Mr. Shaw after it was complete and it was ready to be released. So it is very distressing that the Inspector General's office, which is supposed to be independent and unbiased, would publish a report that is, first of all, not completely accurate, and secondly, it is based on only one side of the story. So I first met Mr. Shaw when he became the head of the Bureau of Independent Review at the Inspector General's office, and he was responsible for monitoring the CDCR's investigation of excessive force and the discipline that was imposed as a result of those investigations. His job was created because of one of the cases that we brought, the Madrid case, which involves Pelican Bay. And the court there found that the CDCR's internal affairs investigations and disciplinary process was a sham and a farce. Mr. Shaw's job, essentially, was to oversee the CDCR's own internal affairs investigators to make sure that they were doing an adequate investigation and imposing appropriate discipline. In other words, Mr. Shaw's job, like mine, was and is to spot problems in the prison system. So during the course of getting to know Dave and working with the Inspector General's office, he taught me a very valuable lesson about investigations, and one that applies very much here as well. He taught me that the scope of the investigation, in other words, how narrowly or broadly a subject or incident is investigated, often is critical to whether the investigation uncovers the appropriate facts. In this report, the OIG takes an extraordinarily narrow focus of scoping. The OIG did not ask why there have been so many lawsuits. It did not ask why these lawsuits have been universally successful in proving unconstitutional conditions in our prisons and juvenile facilities for the past 20 years, why the conditions that were the cause of this litigation Some of them, almost 20 years ago, still persist to this day. It did not ask why the department takes many of these cases to trial or evidentiary hearings instead of settling in the face of clear evidence of unlawful conditions. It did not ask whether any of the department's adversarial conduct during the litigation contributes to the high cost of the litigation. It did not ask whether the department had knowledge of the conditions that led to the lawsuits in time to fix them before the litigation got started. And it did not ask whether the department refused to fix the problems once they were brought to its attention. It did not ask whether it was necessary to pay one firm $10 million, private firm, to defend the state unsuccessfully in several of these lawsuits at rates more than double what they paid the Attorney General's office. It did not ask whether the state is duplicating expenditures by hiring its own large in-house legal staff headed by Mr. Rice, and it also has the Attorney General's office representing it in court. The report says that its purpose is to provide the department and its stakeholders with a snapshot of the significant legal costs associated with its ongoing litigation in federal court. It seems to me that if that truly was the purpose of the report, then at least some of the questions that I just mentioned would have been addressed. The report devotes only a single sentence to why there is litigation against the department, but it is buried in the background section. It says, quote, "Many of the issues raised in these lawsuits highlighted deficiencies in the department's operations and resulted in significant and needed changes. I, of course, agree, but wonder why it didn't prompt Mr. Shaws, the Inspector General, to undertake a broader investigation about why these lawsuits were necessary in the first place, if you want to reduce the cost of litigation." In addition, the report's suggestion that plaintiffs' counsel uncover problems because we have a financial incentive to do so is not only professionally offensive and insulting, but it applies with equal force to Mr. Shaw, his office, the special masters, and the court experts, all of whom work on an hourly, except for Mr. Shaw and his office, the special masters and the court-appointed experts work on an hourly basis. Yet the report does not question the motives of those individuals. Since the Inspector General does not address what I believe to be the major issues posed by the report's articulated purpose, I will provide my perspective. The first point is structural. As five current and former heads of correctional agencies, including one from California, testified in federal court in the overcrowding case, when the population of California prisons approaches 200% of capacity, it is too overcrowded to have a prayer of functioning properly. You want to know how to reduce litigation? You want to know how to reduce litigation costs? Reduce crowding. The second point is the most frustrating and exasperating. Even when serious problems are known, those problems do not get fixed. Sometimes it's because there's no money, but often it is simply because there's no will. And DJJ is a perfect example of that. As you may know, the cost of per youth in DJJ approaches $250,000 per year. As the judge in the Farrell case found, after 4 years of reform, many of the conditions in DJJ that gave rise to the consent decree remain the same, and DJJ is in gross violation of this court's order. Those facts upon which the judge based his opinion were presented by experts and by our monitoring that's been criticized here. And let me give you a recent and tragic example from the adult system. As part of the three-judge panel overcrowding litigation, we hired the most conservative correctional expert we could find. He worked in the Texas prison system for 25 years, rising from a correctional officer in a housing unit to become the director of the entire department in Texas. He toured, at our request, the California Institution for Men in 2007, and in a report that we gave to the department in November of 2007, he said, quote, "In CIM's West facility at Cleveland Hall, I saw 198 prisoners with only two officers to keep order, one in an office with the other roving. Half of the dorm was in another building connected by the shower bathroom area, and one room in the back was completely out of sight. It is impossible to provide any type of security or proper services under these circumstances. Mr. Scott concluded, the housing unit was a serious disturbance waiting to happen. As you may recall, a riot occurred in that exact unit in August of last year, causing millions of dollars of damage and injuring, I believe, over 200 prisoners, sending about 17 of them to the hospital in very serious condition. The third and perhaps most fundamental point is that there is a lot of litigation because the administration has made conscious decisions to litigate rather than to fix the problems that are so readily apparent. Before any of these cases are brought, not a single case is brought before we raise these problems with the department and ask them to fix them, and sometimes we don't even get a response. In some of these cases, I or my co-counsel have literally spent years begging or trying to coax the state into settling the cases without success. After my co-counsel and Michael Bean won a due process case for adults facing parole revocation, for years he virtually begged the department to apply the same due process standards to youth who are more vulnerable and are in more need of protection. Instead of doing that, the state fought the case for years very hard, and there was a lot of time, effort, and money, and finally, after discovery sanctions were awarded for their litigation conduct against the department, they finally settled the case, and now there is a decree. The fourth point, even when the court orders relief, the department doesn't comply with the court orders. So what you've heard from Mr. Shaw and Mr. Rice is they're not complying with the court orders, but there should be less scrutiny rather than more. That doesn't seem to make any sense to me. The Coleman case is a good example. An injunction was issued in 1995, and yet many serious and widespread problems remain with mental health care in the state prison systems. The fifth point is that some of the litigation noted in the report was initiated by the state, but the report does not mention that. In some of the cases, the department, as Mr. Rice said, filed a motion to get rid of the consent decree governing the conditions on death row at San Quentin. The department alleged in its motion that at that time the conditions were constitutional. I don't think it takes a law degree to understand that the conditions that the court described after the trial in rather dry legal prose was shocking and unconscionable. One quote from the court's findings. Despite asking for cleaning supplies three or four times a month, a prisoner was told that there were none available or that the officer would try to find some. The prisoner resorted to cleaning his toilet with his bare hands, which presents a health hazard because he is a diabetic and must have his fingers pricked for blood checks twice a day, resulting in open wounds on his hand. The judge quoted a correctional officer describing recent rodent problems on death row. He said, quote, they had severe mouse problems. Mice were jumping around like popcorn on the floor. The same judge took a tour of the prison and described what happened when prisoners took showers on the tier of the cell blocks. You've been in these cell blocks where they have five tiers. He said, the runoff from the showers contained shaving cream as well as soap scum, shampoo, body hair, shaved skin and detritus, blood particles from open sores and cuts, saliva, mucus, and pus. At the end of each day, prison staff and or inmate workers sweep the pooled, filthy water and detritus out of the entryway and onto the tier. This includes not only the pooled water in the foyer, but also cleanup water used by inmate workers. The outflow then spills across the tier and drips from one tier to the next, some of it lodging in the infrastructure of the tier and some dripping down to the next tier and so on. Some of it reaches the ground floor close to the medical clinics and holding cages where prisoners wait for medical appointments and in front of the first tier, yard side, wheelchair accessible shower. The constant dripping corrodes and degrades the infrastructure. Congealed stalactites of muck and slime, composed of soap scum, hair, and bodily detritus, dangle from the infrastructure. The buildup and water is so disgusting that the prison hangs plastic sheets over the tiers to shelter people working in the medical clinics on the ground floor. During his view of the East Block, the judge observed large accumulations of hair, grime, dirt dangling from the tier infrastructure shower area. The ever-collecting filth is not cleaned or removed. Years of accumulated muck cover the walkway infrastructure. The filthy shower effluent poses a health and safety risk to inmates because it spreads viral and bacterial pathogens. The effluent falls over the tier and aerosolizes into a micromist that circulates throughout the East Block. Furthermore, airborne mold from spores from the shower area contributes to inmates' hard-to-control respiratory problem. Mold is growing in the infrastructure, which is dampened by the runoff. Before this case went to trial, but after they filed their motion, I contacted the governor's office and said, there's no reason we should go to an expensive hearing in this case when the conditions were so unconstitutional. The administration, however, decided to proceed with the litigation. The OIG report does not mention this fact, probably because they never talked to us first. And because they didn't talk to us. More recently, the state filed a motion to get rid of a settlement, like Mr. Rice mentioned, it's called the Clark case, that protects some of the most vulnerable prisoners in the system, those who are mentally retarded. No serious effort was made to resolve the matter through negotiation before the case was filed. Subsequently, after we investigated the conditions, we learned that mentally retarded prisoners are being raped and robbed by other prisoners and verbally abused by correctional officers. And although Mr. Shaw states that we have a financial incentive to continue the litigation, I have done everything in my power to resolve the case short of a hearing so that my clients can get some relief from these terrible conditions as quickly as possible. I asked for a ceasefire. In exchange, I told the department I would show prison officials whom I trust where the problems were, and instead of asking for further court orders, I offered to work with them to resolve the problems.
Mr. Spector?
Yeah.
How much longer do you have?
About a little over.
A couple minutes. Your testimony is very compelling. I don't want to stop that. I just want to be conscious of the time.
I have a page and a half
okay.
left.
Thank you.
Anyway, I asked for a ceasefire. I asked to try and resolve this problem short of litigation, and that order was flatly rejected. I notified the governor's office of my offer. I got no response. An evidentiary hearing will be held this spring, and I am confident that we are going to prevail. Not only are we going to defeat the termination motion, but we are going to ask the court for further orders because we are going to prove that the department is not complying with the settlement agreement. The same pattern has held true in the three-judge panel overcrowding case. I say this without hesitation. No one has worked harder to settle that case short of a trial and even after the trial than me. Yet even though the governor proclaimed a state of emergency because of the overcrowding in 2006, even though the state admitted at trial that overcrowding was one of the causes of inadequate health care, and even though the governor wants to reduce the prison population by about approximately the same amount as the court will order, the litigation continues to this day to the U.S. Supreme Court, and the state has hired one of the country's most experienced Supreme Court litigators at rates which match his talent, experience, and location. All of the attorneys at the prison law office would like nothing more than for the Department of Corrections to put us out of business. I am offended by the statements in the report that suggest otherwise, particularly since Mr. Shaw has known me and some of my other lawyers in my office for many years, and despite his vast investigative resources of his office, not once has he or anyone in his office made any claim that any of our work was frivolous, unfounded, or done for any purpose other than to protect the rights of our clients. We are successful in our cases for one reason.
the terrible and at times shocking conditions support relief under our Constitution and under other laws. Courts do not rule in favor of prisoners lightly and against the state. They do so only after they are convinced that there are no other alternatives. The answer to reducing litigation costs is simple, although it is not found in the report. If the state wants to reduce its litigation costs, it should reduce litigation. That means not bringing motions that have no merit. It means resolving problems before they become federal cases, settling cases that have merit quickly, and once cases are settled or adjudicated, complying with those decrees so my clients can get the relief that they were promised and the case can then be dismissed. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Spector. Sorry I interrupted.
That's no problem.
Any questions, Senator? Or I can dive right in here. I don't want to get into a he said, she said, he said, he said. But Mr. Shaw, one thing is on Mr. Spector's many comments. Is it usual that you would talk to the plaintiffs and before you do a report like this?
I can't think of another report that was similar to this to which I could give you an answer to what we've done in the past. Normally we work with the department and contractors, you know, the receiver, someone like that. I don't know of a parallel. Clearly in retrospect, it might not have been a bad idea, although our purpose in doing the report was to publish the fiscal aspects of it. And certainly, as I've tried to explain to Mr. Spector, we didn't take this on in an attempt to embarrass his firm or him or the people that he works with, who I have a high regard for. As I said earlier, I think that the work the prison law office has done and other plaintiffs' attorneys have clearly improved the conditions within our correction system. I have no issues with that whatsoever. Our point was to start the discussion about our costs, monitoring legal payments and otherwise, and clearly we've done that.
So the genesis of the report, what triggered the report, your interest, and why did you target these cases over this period of time?
Well, these are the big cases, clearly, within the state. As I recall, in late 2006, 2007, our office began taking a look at where the big dollar items were within the department. The legal cost was a significant cost. We started tracking it. Moved towards doing a report. It was on a back burner for a long time. We finally tied it together and went ahead and published it. By the time we published, of course, we'd gone over $100 million. There's no magic to that amount. That's where it was at the time. We decided to go ahead and put that snapshot out. Jerry may be able to offer some additional insight on it.
Well, certainly. Excuse me. As the Inspector General pointed out, we had, based on our previous work with Madrid and Plata, we were aware of significant costs in this area. Clearly, the Department of Corrections, legal and litigation operations and expenses are significant, and they also encompass broad areas, individual inmate suits, employee suits, as well as class actions. And trying to scope our work, the intent is to try and find areas that we know, and while all those areas may merit review at some point in time, this was an area we knew had significant dollars associated with it at this point in time, where both the state and department have significant budget challenges. And so in order to provide information that was relevant and timely, where we knew there were significant dollars in play, we looked at this area.
Sure. Senator Negrete-McLeod.
Thank you for the report. Thank you for your service. I think while we're talking about what the result has been of your report and the cost that it has accumulated over the years, I think the underlying problem to me, just hearing all three of you speak today, is that had we taken care of the problems early on, then we wouldn't have the cost later on. So I think I ask the department, what say you about the underlying problems of why this gentleman has to file? If we took care of problems, if I had a bunion and I let it go, some point I'd have surgery. I don't have bunions, but if I had one, I you know, so if I took care of it and didn't allow it to fester and become a problem, I'd never have the surgery in the last place. So in the first place.
Well, I can't talk about cases that, you know, things occurred in the past. The Coleman case was filed in 91, and I was just getting out of high school at that time, so I can't really talk to that. But what I will tell you is when we look at these cases and you look at the litigation, you know, the comments made by Mr. Spector today on why doesn't the CCR just handle their problems, why do you litigate some of these issues, again, I don't want to get into he said, she said, but clearly there are examples where we have those conversations with Mr. Spector, and there are several reasons why we don't settle, including at times their offers and their demands go well above what's required by the Constitution, and at times we feel that we have to fight because what would be required of us would go beyond that. And I've had those conversations with him and with others, the other law firms, in cases where I've said, your offer goes beyond what's required, and they said, we represent our client zealously, and if we can get more than that, then we will get that. And that has been said to me by people that have worked in firms representing these inmates. And Mr. Spector talks about the report in Lancaster and gives you the parade of horribles and wonders why we just didn't settle that case. What he doesn't tell you is some of the offers and things that were made would have taken a lot of resources and a lot of money to do, and what we did instead was fix those problems. And he doesn't talk about the report that came after that from the magistrate that talked about what a great job the department did and what heroes that the wardens that were at San Quentin and how they fixed the problems and those showers and how they were fixed. And he can say that we shouldn't have litigated, but what the result of that was and us fixing those problems was to get out of that lawsuit and to end monitoring and fix the problem. So I agree with you to the extent in cases where we are not doing what we should be. I think the department takes those problems seriously and we need to fix those. But for the cases where we think we have, we need to end these lawsuits. And in some of the areas, and I've had this conversation with a few special masters in this last week, saying a lot of the ideas you have that go above the Constitution are good ideas. And if the department or the government decides, hey, for better recidivism and for all the following reasons, you should do more than that, then that's what the state government should do. But what's required in the Constitution could be a different level, and we need to make sure that we're not requiring the state to do more. Again, a lot of those ideas can be good, but it shouldn't just be part of the court order. And that's sometimes a disagreement and why we go to litigation.
Mr. Chair, I'd like to just further say, I was the assemblywoman. I live in Chino. I saw the conditions in Chino. I've been to the prison many times. I've been to YTS. I've been to the women's prison. That was my district for 6 years. So I knew what was happening there. So for you to say, you know, we couldn't do this, and the overcrowding has been there for many, many, many years in Chino. It was, as everybody has stated, it was a rash waiting to erupt. And it did. And consequently, it's going to cost the state more money. You know, we were going to fix Chino. They're going to do some other things there. But it brought to the fore everything that is wrong with the prison system.
Some questions for CDCR. Do you have a process in terms of, well, first of all, how many attorneys do you have within the department?
It's roughly the positions. We have vacancies now, but it's roughly 100. I will tell you, because that name, and it's happened in hearings before, and people wonder why we don't have more resources to work on these particular cases, is that there are, you know, we're 60,000-plus organization. We have more than roughly half of our attorneys work on what has been described by Don Spector, the Madrid case, where we do employee discipline, and those attorneys work on that and that case alone, on those issues on employee discipline and the vertical advocacy process of disciplining employees that work there. So, but then you have several other teams. We enter into millions and millions of dollars in contracts. You have attorneys that work on that, attorneys that work on the C CEQA cases, and then I have attorneys that work on, you have like a team that works on employee issues outside of the discipline, so you have a sexual harassment lawsuit or things like that, workers' comp issues for, again, 60,000 plus. You have teams that work and advise the parole office and the institutions on what they can do and can't do. The number of lawyers that work on these cases is smaller. It has gone up since I've been here 18 months. It certainly has become a focus of mine, and have tried to put more resources and focus on these cases, on the class actions especially. But again, that number is well below 25% of on all the inmate cases, not just the class actions that work on these cases.
Is that number unusually small compared to other large states? The number of 100?
Compared to, I'm sorry? To
other large states. I mean, on a per capita basis.
Well, I think it'd be difficult to say, because in other cases, in other states, for example, you have states where the AG's office basically acts, they give a lot of attorneys, instead of giving some in-house, they give a lot of attorneys to the Attorney General's office, and they basically act as an in-house counsel for...
You know what I'm trying to get at. I'm just trying to get some...
I don't know.
As a generalist, I'm trying to figure out how overwhelmed you are in-house. Do you have a policy or tell me the process to determining to go outside and hire someone outside, and do you have any kind of cost controls or reimbursement considerations, or is it bid competitively?
The process essentially is, you know, we don't have the right to do it on our own to go to outside counsel. It is the Attorney General's office is the attorney for the state, and they are the litigation attorneys. There are two main reasons why they would send a case to us and say, you got to go outside. And one is a lack of resources, which they've done a lot of those cases over the last 12 months, saying we didn't get enough attorneys to handle these type of cases. They have sent a significant number of cases back to us saying, we can't handle this. You need to go seek outside counsel. And then the other issue, it's used to be a bigger percentage. Now it's a smaller percentage because of the first issue. The second issue is if there's a conflict. So you have two correctional officers pointing fingers, saying, one saying, I didn't do it, and one saying, I didn't do it, I saw him do it. You have a conflict. We have to go get outside counsel. In those cases, we negotiate with outside attorneys. There's not a competitive bid process in the sense that you have time. A lot of times the Attorney General's office will get the case, or we will get it. We'll get served. By the time it routes the Attorney General's office, they send it back to us. There's 8 days to answer to go get outside counsel. We have firms that we've worked with in the past, and we have negotiated rates with them to handle some of these cases. And we've had to, he talked about the outside attorneys and some of the bigger cases, and there's the Attorney General's office didn't have the experience to handle larger class actions in these areas. They've given us or didn't have the resources at that time. They've sent it to us to go get help for them, for those attorneys, and we've sent it to outside counsel to help in those cases.
What's the range of reimbursement rates? Mr. Spector alluded to one firm in particular, and I've heard that that's up to $1,100 an hour.
For the smaller cases, the civil rights cases, they are basically below market rate. We get for attorneys that charge roughly at or near what the Attorney General's office charges when we get to negotiate. Some clearly are higher as the level goes up. It goes up. In the Supreme Court, we did hire a Supreme Court attorney that has a lot of experience. I will tell you that we interviewed several of the attorneys, and all of them were at or near that rate. One thing that was, besides his experience and our comfort level with him, is that he agreed to cap his fees, unlike some of the other attorneys who said, I'll give you a 10% discount, but I'm going to get the full board. We capped it at, I'll get my full rate, and if you stop, if something happens, you settle, whatever, I get my full rate. But if this goes the distance, you only pay X amount of dollars, and so that, judging by what he has charged his other clients when they go full board, it basically comes out to about half of what another client of his would pay, a private client would pay, if it went the full distance. So we didn't get a cap on his fees, and it is a very high dollar amount. I certainly wish I got paid that amount. But what we got from him was a cap at a level that it doesn't go beyond this dollar amount. which I can tell you he's going to share, is it goes up to $275,000.
Tell me, just off of my personal experience, we all go off our personal experience, fortunately or unfortunately, when I was a county supervisor, including cases against the county sheriff's office and the jail system, we would go into closed session, and usually we would have county council give us a report that included the percentage of likelihood of prevailing if we go to trial. Mm-hmm. And then if we had outside counsel, they would do the same thing. Do you go through that kind of process? Because basically that focuses you on the fiscal cost and whether it's worth it to go to litigation or not.
Oh, sure, absolutely. We get we have an analysis on these cases, and on the small cases we get an analysis that says, you know, here's, you had an inmate who was hurt, or, you know, in horrible circumstances where an inmate has died. You know, here's what happened. We've looked at, we've talked to the officers that were there, we have our experts, and here's what your liability looks like. We think you should prevail, but you have a X percent chance of losing. If you lose, it's going to be $1 million. It's going to cost you, you know, $80,000 to go, and you make that cost-benefit analysis on a case.
So have you gone back and reviewed that and to see how accurate it's been?
We know when it comes back from the cases. I don't know how far back you mean. I mean, when it comes...
You just explained a process to
right.
me, so I would want to go back. So you made a decision to go through litigation because you thought that would save you money,
mm-hmm.
and you could prevail. So do you go back and look if you've been accurate or not?
After a case is gone on those individual cases, I haven't done it on a system-wide basis on all these, on a percentage-wise, have I been right to settle or not settle? I haven't done that.
But the institution doesn't have a process or policy that says we're gonna track and look at how accurate we've been over time vis-a-vis what it cost us as litigation went on, and when's a good time to settle just from a fiscal standpoint?
Not on an overall system-wide basis, no.
Wouldn't you say that would be a good thing? I mean, it strikes me that'd be a good thing, not just as an institution. And as you said, you were in high school when some of these cases started.
No, I think it would if it's possible, you know, if we had the resources and the system to do that, and trying to figure out exactly whose percentage you're talking about. You know, when I take the Attorney General's office opinion of it, and when I look at it, sometimes I'll make an independent assessment and think, I disagree. The Attorney General's office has told me it's 70. I think it's 80 and or whatever. And so I guess you could do with a dual system. And there's just a lot of parts to decide what is a victory versus, you know, a complete win versus, you know, in the case I talked about in these cases, sometimes you won't win, but you'll win a few issues, and those issues might be worth a dollar amount to you. It'd be really hard to figure out.
Sorry, I just, in a relatively small county of 1 million people in Contra Costa, I can talk about specific cases against the sheriff's department mm-hmm. in their jails that aren't as burdened as yours, but over time I was there for 14 years. And we would call outside counsel back in and said, you advised us this was the probability. This is how much we've cost because we did litigate.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it doesn't seem that hard to do.
Well, on an individual case,
it should be part of the contract.
We certainly have those conversations on the individual cases. I thought you were asking, like, on an overall basis, were we right on an overall strategy to litigate? But on an individual case, sure, we'll go back and say, you told us that this issue was a slam dunk for us, but we had issues here. Certainly, we've had those conversations.
But is it in a policy that you would look at it and evaluate it so that you could sort at least get on a track? Secretary Kate told me some time ago that one of his primary objects in the period before the administration leaves is that he want to eliminate as many of these lawsuits as possible and the conditions that were causing them, obviously. Mm-hmm. So I assume that there's some analytical tools that look at and evaluate that. And I'm just trying to get to, is it institutionalized? Is there an objective process? And that when you're wrong, you're wrong, and you try to make sure that that doesn't happen again.
Not an institutionalized basis. I will tell you that there's a new team that was created recently that is looking at risk management and claims, and certainly that can be a part of what that team puts in their analysis. Right now they look at factors, risk factors, places where we're liable for future lawsuits or financial liabilities, et cetera, and that's certainly something that team can look to maybe institutionalize.
I'm not comfortable with being – I wouldn't have made a good – prosecuting attorney. We have a problem, and it's even more demonstrative given what the governor said yesterday. I mean, we've had a problem for a long time in this state. It's not blame, it's just we've got to fix it. If we were to have his constitutional amendment tomorrow, and we would have to spend less on the department than the CSU and UC system, we would be terminating a lot of these cases, or at least we would have a strategy over 10 years of how we could terminate them and settle with the plaintiff's attorneys. And I would suggest that some form of that is probably going to happen in the next few years. Mr. Chair, you're appointed by the administration, confirmed by the Senate. Is it a fixed term?
6 years.
6 years, okay. In terms of just, it seems to me, a somewhat of an inherent conflict, given that you have a six-year term and you'll serve in different administrations. And again, in the spirit of we're trying to collectively fix this, and I know what it can be, with all due respect to Mr. Spector. I'm from San Francisco. I served on regional agencies. I know, I'm choosing my words here, what some people would call a litigious community. And I've also been on governing bodies where they were being sued so often, it just seemed like you started to get more defensive. And maybe that was the right, it's just Pavlov's dog, I suppose. So if we were going to fix this, how do we do it? I mean, I'm concerned about at least the appearance of a conflict of interest where you were appointed by this governor, and I'm not criticizing him. I just sense his frustration yesterday sitting in the front row watching him give his state of the state with this department, and his inability to, not his inability, the administration's difficulty in trying to at least look at a pattern where, and I, to the department, I think there's been some real serious efforts, and I commend that, to fix the problem. But how do you be impartial and give us and the administration and the public the kind of information? And it strikes me that not calling the plaintiff's attorneys, I mean, just as an average citizen, that would intuitively strike you as, well, you're giving us a report that may be hedging your bets a little bit. And the ultimate goal is not to fix blame, it's to fix the problem and get this department back to what I understand it used to have on a national and international level, that this was something to aspire to be like the California Department of Correction. And again, I understand the external pressures on the department you work under, so I'm not trying to ascribe blame, it's just how do we fix it?
Well, a lot of ground there, but we're an independent agency. As you pointed out, I'm appointed by the governor, confirmed by the Senate to a term. We're not part of cabinet. The governor's office has never, in the 5.5 years I've been at the office, asked us to change a report or go to a particular direction or outcome of any kind. Our statute, as reformed 3 or 4 years ago, makes it very clear that we're not a part of any other entity. And I assume I frequently publish reports that the administration probably wishes would have gone a slightly different way. And in very recent memory, clearly I published one that garnered national attention and was very critical of the department and its handling of a particular case. And there have been, countless numbers of reports where we've found serious misconduct and malfeasance on the part of the department, which has caused major change in the department. Possibly not as much as the prison law office has caused over time, but this is probably the first time in the 5.5 years that I've been at the IG's office that I haven't stood shoulder to shoulder with Mr. Spector on almost every issue, especially in Madrid, where we brief the same federal court day in and day out about the problems with officer misconduct and employment prosecution within the system. So I think I'm proud of the independence that we have, and probably the next reports that will come out will go a slightly different way. But it is as we find them. Our office is made up of CPAs like Mr. Toomey and attorneys and investigators. Everybody that works for us has a significant amount of experience in the system, and we tell it like it is. And I think if you look at all of our reports over time, we do try to present a balanced approach when we speak. I would say about this report that, again, this was intended to be a very narrow slice. It was a fiscal report. We talked about plaintiffs in general, and we named two firms within the body of the report, including the prison law office, only because they had a significant amount of the cases. But this was not intended to be an indictment against he or the private firm that we had mentioned. And in particular, I would say that when we said that there was an appearance of a conflict, we also stated that we found no conflict in the legal representation that Mr. Spector and his office had undertaken. So we're I think we're all after basically the same objective, and that is having a stellar correctional system in California. We're part of that, and you know, we will continue to do that. We're transparent. Unlike the Inspector General of 6 years ago, our office now is able to publish everything that we do, and we do that. And there are certain limitations with Peace Officer Bill of Rights and so on, but everything that we do is up on our website, and we're open to public scrutiny, and certainly we have a lot of correspondence with the legislature, and we're proud to continue to do that.
We'll wrap up here. Mr. Spector, how long have you done this kind of work?
Too long.
I'm not trying to date you.
Yeah, since 1980.
Yeah. As us folks with gray hair, it's more providing an opportunity to you display your wisdom. Yeah. Has the situation in terms of both litigiousness but more the causes gotten better or worse in the time you've done this?
I would say, in fairness to this administration, that other administrations have been often as boneheaded.
That's high praise.
Yes, and difficult to deal with. Recently, with this administration, there's been a... And I don't know whether it's Mr. Rice or the Attorney General, because I don't sit in on those conversations, so I'm not, or the Governor's office, which has their legal team too. But there recently, we're in a no-holds-barred fight to the death about everything, about whether we can review prisoner files. We had to make a motion to review our own clients' files. That's just one little example of how ridiculous the litigation has gotten. And there seems to be, in my opinion, in terms of this administration, and I've heard it articulated at various times, A, they want us out, which is understandable. I get that. But B, it's like, well, when problems, I present problems, it's like, well, let's let the courts decide what the constitutional minimum is, and then we'll try to fix that instead of, oh, we have a problem. We want to run a responsible correctional agency. Let's try to fix the problem and work with the plaintiffs. Like, I know people in the department I can work with, but I can't work with them because everything now is we can't talk to them virtually. We have to go through the attorneys. So the people I've developed and my staff has developed relationships with for years who we can accomplish a small but relatively significant change, but they don't let us talk and work cooperatively together. The other point, the last point I'll say is that this is history repeating itself, and we've gone through these cycles over and over and over again, that we bring problems to the attention. They say, no, we're not going to, we want to litigate, we litigate, we win. So after 20 or 30 years, you'd think that when I bring a problem to their attention, they would say, okay, well, he's got a pretty good track record of winning, and B, he's got a pretty good track record of being right about what the conditions are, so let's work with him to solve the problem rather than litigate. But it's the exact opposite. So, I mean, they have their own internal, you know, and external reasons for doing that. But from my perspective and from my client's perspective and from the litigation cost perspective, it doesn't make any sense.
Okay. I appreciate your testimony. I'd like to be able to have more time to continue but today.
Sure.
But I would certainly like to have open individual conversations about how we can make this better. So thank you for your time, gentlemen.
Thank you.
We'll go to the next panel. Next panel is CDCR, and the title is, it's poor, I didn't write this, internal controls allowed facilities to overpay employees for inmate supervision, and we've got the auditor with us, hello, Ms. Howe, and Mr. Lewis. Welcome.
Hi. Nice to meet you. Good morning, Mr. Chair. For the record, my name's Elaine Howell. I'm the California State Auditor. To my left is Stephen Russo. He's the chief of my investigative division. The subject of this particular panel discussion is an investigative report we issued this past November related to payments to employees regarding inmate supervision. And this was an investigation that my office actually initiated based on some previous investigations we had conducted at other facilities. And basically what the concern is that state employees at correctional facilities are entitled to differential pay or a certain amount of pay in the event they are supervising inmates, and there are certain requirements. They have to supervise a minimum of two inmates, and those inmates collectively have to work 173 hours during the course of a month. And an investigation we conducted back in October of 2008 at a specific facility, R.J. Donovan in Southern California, and looking at a specific classification of employees, office technicians, we identified nine individuals who were receiving that pay differential but were not meeting the requirements of supervising two inmates and those inmates working those hours. Prior to that, we had issued an investigation back in March of 2005 related to some nurses, again, who were receiving this type of pay but, again, weren't meeting the requirements to deserve that additional pay. So we decided we had two investigations. We needed to perhaps do a broader investigation and look at additional facilities and additional classifications. So we conducted this investigation this past year, visited six different facilities, took a random sample of payments, identified some employees who had been receiving those payments, and then looked for the support, timesheets, documentation both for the inmate hours and for the employee hours. And in addition to that, individuals who supervise inmates, their supervisor is eligible for the differential as well. So if I'm supervising Stephen and he's supervising inmates, I get the differential as well. And that's an important point that I'll get back to when I complete my comments. So we conducted this investigation, looked at six different facilities, identified 23 employees who had received payments in circumstances where they had not met those specific requirements to be eligible for the payments. The reason we took a statistical sample is so that we could project potential overpayments to the universe of all 33 institutions to determine the significance of these payments that, you know, where the individuals had not met the requirements to receive the supplemental pay. We identified 23 employees at these facilities. Five of the six facilities that we visited had circumstances where they didn't either have the documentation to support those payments or the documentation didn't indicate that that employee had supervised two inmates, those inmates had worked the appropriate number of hours. For those 23 employees, looking at a one-year window, we identified about $35,000 in overpayments or improper payments. Projecting that to the universe, we believe it could be as much as $588,000 potentially that could be paid out during this 12-month window across all 33 institutions. We made some recommendations to the department to make sure that they improve their internal controls. Specifically, make sure that your employees are submitting timesheets. Make sure the inmates are submitting their timesheets. Personnel should be the entity that's reviewing those timesheets to determine whether or not employees are eligible. Getting back to the supervisor, if the supervisor is reviewing, if I'm reviewing Stephen's timesheets and if I decide that he's not eligible for the differential, then I am, as a supervisor, I'm not eligible for the differential. So you need a control such as the personnel office or the accounting office, whichever handles timekeeping, a separate independent unit within the institution to control that, to make sure that those that do supervise inmates and are eligible rightfully get that differential, but those who are not should not. So this is a way that the state could save some funds as far as paying these differentials to these employees. In addition, we felt that there needed to be training provided to personnel to understand what the nature of the documentation they should be looking for, how they should be doing their analysis, et cetera. And then, of course, our recommendation was for those employees that we identified that had improperly received payments for supervising inmates, we needed to set up accounts receivable and recoup those funds for those specific employees. We made similar recommendations in the previous investigation that we issued in October of 2008. And one of the things, to be quite frank, we're somewhat disappointed is the department seems to be slow in implementing some of those recommendations. in feeling that they need to. They went to DPA, got some an opinion from DPA. Stephen can speak to that some. We felt that some of what the DPA opinion was addressing wasn't really relevant to the concerns that we raised in our investigation. So we feel the department needs to be more aggressive in this particular area and broadening some of the work that they've asked their institutions to do. For example, when we did the R.J. Donovan investigation and published it back in October of 2008, the department did direct their facilities to take a look at this, but they limited it to that particular classification, where there are numerous classifications within the institutions that have employees who are eligible for this type of supplemental pay. So that kind of in a nutshell is the investigation that we published in November. And as I said, we had conducted two previous investigations where we came up with similar findings. In one case, the R.J. Donovan, it was only 9 office technicians. It was about $16,000. But the investigation we conducted back in March of 2005, it was 25 nurses, and it was $238,000 in payments that we identified that we felt were improper. So with that, I'll stop and allow you to ask questions or allow the department to
have the department's comments.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My name is Lee Seal. I'm the Deputy Chief of Staff at CDCR. I'd like to thank the committee for the opportunity to be here today. I'd also like to thank the State Auditor for their work on this report and the opportunities we've had to work with them on numerous reports. The Office of the Inspector General, if they're still here as well. I'd like to say at the outset that the Secretary is very committed to accountability and correcting the kinds of issues that we find both internally and the kinds of issues that our external auditors bring to our attention. One of the first things he did was created a separate chain of command inside CDCR so that there could be an internal check on operations to kind of double back, follow up on corrective action plans so that when the state auditor brings something like this to our attention, we can create a process and have a very good process, I believe, for following up on corrective action plans and ensuring that appropriate recommendations are implemented. So specifically to this report, there's not a lot of disagreement on from our end on this report. I work personally with some of the auditors. We have a team and staff that worked with the auditors. I don't think that we experience really any significant disagreement. We recognize the issue. We agree that it's a problem. We are on our way to implementing fixes. I think in the coming months we'll be able to show that we have procedures and policies and training in place that will correct this, and it will be on a statewide basis. I absolutely agree that this is not something that should be piecemealed or institution by institution or classification by classification. I believe that in the coming months we'll be able to demonstrate that we have implemented the types of fixes that the state auditor has asked for. I understand also the point that the department should be moving more aggressively to rectify this problem, and I'd like to acknowledge that it is a cause of concern for us that this issue has been raised and going back to 2005. I can say that when the issue came up in late 2008, I do believe that the department has taken appropriate steps since then. I understand, having worked in state government, that it's not fast. It's never fast enough. And from an outside perspective, it probably looks like we're moving much too slowly. But when we're attempting to rectify a problem like this where we have made improper payments to employees, unfortunately, the very circumstances that make those payments improper, for example, lack of documentation, to support those payments are sometimes the very circumstances that make it difficult for us to recoup those payments from those employees. In other words, when they, as they have litigated this issue in front of the PERB and other courts, our efforts to recoup those processes, those monies have been stalled. So we wanted to move carefully in consultation with DPA, who promulgates the rules concerning the pay differential. I think it was entirely appropriate that we went to them. We asked for their interpretation of their own regulation governing this, and we're consulting with our legal team to make sure that when we do move forward to recoup these monies, we do it in a way that doesn't compound the problem by, you know, the amount of money we're talking about here could easily be offset by, you know, a little bit of litigation costs. So we want to make sure that we fix the problem on a go-forward basis, and in terms of recouping the monies, we do it in a way that's smart, that's going to avoid unnecessary litigation.
Okay, appreciate that. So you can come back in 2 months and demonstrate that you have fixed the problem.
I think within 2 months we will have policies and procedures in place that will demonstrate to the state auditor and this committee that we have achieved the recommendations that they've asked for. Obviously, not in 2 months will we have a system for recouping those monies yet. That's going to. I don't think I can sit here and make a prediction as to how that will
proceed. But in 2 months, you could come back and explain to us adopted the two recommendations from the auditor and basically assure us that you've fixed the situation ongoing in the future. On the issue of the supervisor approving, is it Stephen?
Yes.
Yeah. So Stephen is getting away with this, and Ms. Howe's encouraging her. It does seem there's an inherent conflict of interest. Can you do something about that?
I agree. I think that will also be among our fixes. As I understand it, talking to staff, we are embracing the recommendations wholeheartedly.
Okay. We'll see you back in a couple months.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. That'll bring us to our last panel for today, and this is the CDCR. It fails to track and use data that would allow it to more effectively monitor and manage its operations. And this is from the Bureau of State Audits from September of last year. Ms. Howe.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Again, for the record, my name is Elaine Howell, California State Auditor. To my right is Tammy Lozano. She was the audit project manager on this particular project. To my left is John Klein, who is the audit supervisor. This is an audit that the Joint Legislative Audit Committee approved last year, and specifically in the scope of the audit, we were asked to try to identify certain costs that the Department of Corrections incurs with regard to their operations, and specifically asked to try to stratify some of those costs, for example, by security level, by age, by gender, et cetera, of the inmates. And we had difficulty in doing much of that, as we explain in this audit report, because the department doesn't collect some of that type of data. So I'm going to go through some, about a page and a half highlights of just some of the issues, not everything that's in the report. It's a fairly substantial report, but I think there's a few key issues that we identified that I'd like to talk about, and reasons why we think it's important that they track this type of data. First of all, as the representatives from Legislative Analyst's Office indicated, the $10 billion budget for the Department of Corrections, 80% of that is adult operations. And when we looked at a three-year window, the corrections expenditures increased 32%. Inmate population in that same three-year window had decreased by 1%. So you've got to be able to look at and do analysis of what's driving our expenditures and where are our costs, so that we can be as effective and efficient as we possibly can to try to keep costs down. One of the first key findings that we had is corrections lacks the data necessary to specifically identify factors that are driving costs. Is it overcrowding? Is it health care? How much is healthcare driving costs up versus overcrowding? Is it the escalating overtime? We saw a significant amount of overtime being worked by correctional officers. Does the age of an inmate have an impact on the cost that the department is incurring as far as caring for those particular inmates. You would presume that would be true. As we all age, health care costs certainly get higher for us, but they can't specify because they don't have that particular information. What we had to do when we conducted our audit was really use the department's accounting records to try to separate costs such as medical costs versus housing and security custody type costs. But again, you can't specifically identify costs and tie those to a specific unit. For example, we have an appendix in the report that shows a couple of institutions, their average cost to incarcerate an inmate, the CS Sacramento Prison, over $80,000. Well, why is it $80,000 versus the average, which is $49,500? And in looking at some of the costs, we determine that health care, because they provide mental health services at CS Sacramento, or Cal State Prison Sacramento, but does the Department of Corrections, can they specifically identify which inmates are receiving those types of services, what's the costs are for those particular types of populations by security level, by custody level, et cetera? And the answer to that is no. That's why we've highly recommended that they try to capture some of this information as quickly as possible. They also, despite rising costs for incarcerating inmates, Corrections does not have sufficient information to identify how specific inmate or institution characteristics contribute to costs. The reason this is important is in the event, you know, the state is able to reduce overcrowding and reduce the number of inmates in facilities, and we are confronted with the decision, which institutions do we shut down? Which institutions do we begin to move inmates into other institutions that may be more efficient? That data is not available for the department to be able to do those types of analyses, comparing the efficiency of one institution versus another, and determine whether or not this is a much older institution. Is that why the costs are significantly higher? Do we need more custody staff in this facility because it's not as modern as another facility? Those are the types of things we were really looking for, and that's what the audit committee asked us to try to take a look at, to see if we could stratify that to allow the legislature and the administration and future administrations to make informed decisions with regard to policy and with regard to operations at these institutions. Also, the other area that I was going to highlight today is the academic and vocational programs. We were asked to look at that as well, and one of our findings is, although Corrections, their budget for academic and vocational programs was over $200 million in fiscal year 8-9, they had no way of assessing whether or not those programs were efficient. Were they reducing recidivism rates? Were the inmates who needed and were assessed and determined needed certain types of program. One is prison literacy, and I'll touch on that a little bit in a couple of minutes. But they didn't have the ability to determine whether or not I as an inmate was receiving the program needs that were determined I should get when I was first assessed coming into the institution. So they can't determine, is this vocational program more effective in reducing recidivism versus a different program, and making choices about, if we're going to continue to fund at least a certain amount of academic and vocational programs, which are programs that we should invest our money in that are achieving success. Also, we were asked by the audit committee in this particular request to look at the process that Department of Corrections uses to determine how many teachers and how many instructors are needed at each of the institutions and which institutions should certain programs be provided. And again, they didn't have a staffing plan for determining how many instructors and what teachers and what classes should be provided at the various institutions. Again, making it difficult to determine how effective programs are and making it difficult to make proper staffing decisions and decisions related to various institutions. When we talked to the Department of Corrections regarding the academic and vocational programs, their perspective or their position was that their staffing plans are developed when an institution is initially activated. and some of those can go back to 1990s, years and years. And the only time there may be a modification is if there is a budget change proposal or there's a decision that we want to start a program or modify a program at this institution. So we weren't seeing staffing plans, so a really good strategic approach, again, to make sure that we're using our scarce dollars as efficiently as we can. So we highly recommended that they need to come up with some kind of a staffing plan. I know we did acknowledge in the report that there have been reductions, certainly in the academic and vocational programs. But again, if the intent, one of the goals is to reduce recidivism, we've got to be more strategic in the use of academic and vocational programs in the institutions and coming up with a staffing plan for hiring teachers and instructors. The other information that we didn't see is information on inmates who have been on a waiting list to get into a program. And one of the concerns that we had is some inmates may be on a waiting list, but if they're paroled, that information is not kept. So if that inmate reoffends and ends up back in the institution, that historical information is gone. They don't maintain that. If that individual is transferred to another institution, they're not keeping that historical information. So they're not able to track the needs of particular inmates and whether or not inmates are on waiting lists for a long period of time, whether or not they have been able to get access to particular programs. And again, tying this into trying to be successful in providing vocational education and training to individuals so that they don't reoffend and their, you know, their potential for staying out of prison and in society is greater. The department itself, when we talked to them about some of this information, they did acknowledge that they're not able to track the overall success of education programs or to quantify the number of inmates who actually complete programs, whether or not they're improving their reading scores or assess the relationship between recidivism and these enrollment in these programs. So, again, they're not able to assess the efficiency of the programs, the effectiveness of those programs, so that you can make strategic decisions about these programs seem to be working, these are not, so let's fund these particular programs. The last piece, and then I'll stop and turn it over to the department or certainly attempt to answer any questions you may have, is there's a specific state law, Prison Literacy Act, and this requires the Department of Corrections to determine the reading level of every inmate upon commitment. Also to implement a state prison literacy program that would be designed to assist inmates and get them upon parole to be at least achieving a ninth grade reading level. This program also needs to be available to 60% of the inmates in the state prison system. Again, what we found is although the department produces a monthly report, it's an aggregate report, so you can't determine the test scores for a specific inmate and whether or not the inmates who are receiving reading services are those who truly need those services. We looked at a February 2009 report. The department had tested 133,000 inmates. 68,000 of them, a little over 68,000, scored below ninth grade reading level. But because they don't track it by individual inmate data, we don't know which of those 68,000 inmates are receiving those types of services and how successful those who are receiving the reading program services are. So, again, another example of where the department's not tracking certain data that, again, we think would be very important both for the administration, future administrations, as well as the legislature, and making informed decisions about where to invest general fund dollars, certainly for academic and vocational programs. Those are just a few examples of what's in the audit report. As I'm sure you're aware, whenever we issue an audit, the department's required to respond to us at certain intervals. There's a 60-day interval, a 6-month interval, and a 1 year. We've received a 60-day response. They do talk about developing some information technology systems. Some of the timelines for those are relatively, 2012. And one of our recommendations is in the event you're not able to get an IT system up and running immediately, you need to come up with some alternative approaches in the interim so that you do have some of this data. I would also suggest that as the department is moving forward in using or hiring someone to develop this type of system that they share with the legislature. Here is the information that we will be capturing, and here's how we're going to use it so that we're making informed decisions, that we get an IT system that really is going to do and provide the data to allow the department to do the analysis it needs to do. So we really need to be kept informed about this is how we're going forward in developing this IT system, this is what we think it will be able to accomplish for us, and here's the type of reporting and analysis we'll be able to do in the future using this data. So those were just a couple of examples, again, of things that we think are important, and I'll stop with that.
Department, Mr. Seal.
Again, thank you, Lee Seal, Deputy Chief of Staff. As with the first report, I'd like to thank the State Auditor's Office. This was a wide-ranging report. It really covers every aspect of our business from top to bottom. So I'll do the best to speak on issues as they come up as best I can. Insofar as the State Auditor is saying it is very important to collect this data, we absolutely agree. We are in the midst of a transition right now, and it's really a gargantuan task that we're in the midst of right now. We have two of the largest IT systems in the state that we're trying to implement. One is Business Information System, BIS. This covers all of our costs, our financials, accounting, procurement, contracts, HR. Mr. Lewis can speak with a lot more knowledge about that than I can. The second system is SOMS, our Strategic Offender Management System, and this will have a lot of the demographic type of data and institutional data that the State Auditor is asking that we bring together with the costs. Now, you know, it really was not that long ago, 2005 or so, that we were trying to, as a department, make the transition from, you know, cobbled together legacy systems, Excel spreadsheets, institution by institution systems of maintaining and tracking information. I understand that. That's problematic. A department our size can't work with those kinds of systems. So to move forward, I'm absolutely optimistic that we're headed in the right direction. Right now, we're in the middle of a transition. So in an audit period like this, they're catching us a lot more flat-footed than we'd like to be, a lot more flat-footed than I think we'll be a year from now, 2 years from now. The timelines, again, are always further out than we'd like to see. I'm eager to see this data right now. I know our programs people are eager to see this data. I have research staff that works for me, and we're trying the best we can to, in some cases, put together interim makeshift solutions that will, for example, provide individualized data on education and literacy. We're beta testing some of those systems right now. We'd be happy to share that or invite the auditors over to take a look at some of those systems as we develop them. But really, the big solution will be when we unveil BIS, and that will be this year. It won't be 2012, we hope. We're optimistic that our financials will be fully functional this year. We will be able to start merging data to speak to that those costs. In other words, right now we do have some data. Our costs are really in a transition phase, but once we get the cost system through BIS up and running, we'll be able to merge that and begin doing analytics through a program called SAS that we'll be able to produce external reports. SOMS, the Strategic Offender Management System, is beginning this year with we're starting the implementation process. The State Auditor is absolutely correct that that process will go into 2012, but we hope to see paperless C-files, offender and institution information coming online line this year, certainly extend into 2011, 2012. But until we get those systems up and running, and once we do, then they will be able to, so to speak to each other via a single enterprise-wide solution where we can do the kind of stratification analysis that we absolutely agree is very important.
Senator Cheney?
Well, is this the same famous CMI system we've been talking about since, like, 1997?
No, that system was discontinued. This system we have been talking about only for, well, a fairly long period of time, since 2003, and it's coming forward. I mean, it's slower than we would like. There's a lot of factors that have had to been dealt with, because taking an off-the-shelf system from another state and implementing it, or from another system and implementing it here, is more difficult than maybe we had anticipated. And it's very costly, so it's cost a lot of money, and it's maybe a little slower than we would like, but we're definitely making progress.
That's for I'm hearing you talk about three or four different systems, and IT being the problem child that it is generically in this state, not just you. But yours have been priority, as we've talked about IT solutions over the last few years and some of the problems with procurement and everything. Your system's one of the ones that I think a lot of folks think can save money, precisely for a lot of the reasons we're talking about, whether you can keep track of your employees and their overtime or not or whatever, and more importantly, can you keep track of your case management and, you know, this question of files, you know, taking longer to get from one end of the state to the other than the prisoner does.
Sure.
Has been an ongoing problem, and it's a doubled problem in the health area. I mean, in the current environment, the fact that health files and not having e-filing, you know, the ability to access for one parole officer or case management officer in Ironwood to be able to, you know, access the case management file of the guy when he gets transferred from Chino, it makes it impossible to program them, to do them right, to figure out if they belong in the literacy, not in the literacy. I mean, that case management system has been the biggest one. So that's the SOMS thing that you talk about?
That's correct. That would be SOMS.
And the BIS thing is one that's going to, like, talk to finance or something?
And the BIS system has replaced our accounting system. It's replacing our HR systems and our procurement systems.
Is it going to be compatible with the controller's new 21st century thing and the Department of Finance's fiscal thing or what?
Well,
we're going to have to design those to fit you because we didn't do it backwards.
We've worked with the Controller's Office and with Department of Finance on both those projects. Obviously, both of those are in the future and will hopefully undoubtedly be some adjustments that will need to be made on our end to ensure compatibility. But our hope is that those will communicate with each other, yes.
So when do we get... The case management one we're starting? Where are we?
The case management one, we've gone through the procurement process, and we're beginning implementation this fiscal year. And the BIS system will be completed by the end, hopefully by the end of this fiscal year.
This fiscal year, so June?
By June, yes.
So we need, like, regular updates during the next 6 months. I just think... Because we ought to be able to project, if those things go online, some savings in different ways. And we need to start kind of focusing on that even before the governor does whatever he's going to do tomorrow. I mean, we need to find these systemic savings that are there that should create assumptions that allow us to lower our hysteria about, you know, deficits in the future if we can get a handle on some of this stuff. And certainly these performance ones, given the reforms and all the stuff we tried to do this year, you know, if you can't track, are they in fact getting the drug rehab, and then when they're on parole, are they staying out, and, you know, what have they stayed out of prison for 2 years after they got ninth grade literacy? Maybe if you can't do that, we have trouble making all the other things make sense. If we know that, if we had data, which, I mean, goes with our natural instincts, that if you get people to the ninth grade reading level, or maybe even a 10th grade reading level, that those inmates are less likely to reoffend, then that's huge if for targeting resources and saying, okay, the guys who fit that model are the ones we want to push toward parole in terms of the new system that we're doing and you know, and not getting into, I know, I'm sorry I missed the earlier part about the lawsuits, but I mean, this whole thing of not being able to count credits is just insane, that people have to fight to get credits when we're trying to deal with overcrowding and we're keeping people more time than they're supposed to be, or letting them out earlier than they're supposed to. I mean, either one is bad, and we had some experience with that a couple of years ago that was pretty bad. Have we fixed that one yet?
Yes. Relating to the credit earnings, we've developed an interim IT solution to try and address the credit earnings and credit calculations. Prior to the last couple of years, those were all calculated by hand by a case records analyst.
I remember that.
And we have since then ensured that they all have an IT solution.
And has that IT solution been updated for the new?
Yes.
New whatever we just did.
Yes, it has. And we are on track to be able to provide those credits starting on the 25th when SB 18 XXX kicks in.
Oh, it doesn't go into effect till the end of the month because of the delays, huh?
Yes.
Okay, I was thinking it had to go into effect by the 1st. So what else have you got that has to go into effect by the end of this month? And what are those?
The summary parole, or what we're now calling non-revocable parole, also goes into effect in that time period as well.
Okay. And and on this procurement business, how involved has the Office of, what do we call them, information, whatever, TAKAI, how involved, OCIO, whatever?
They've been very involved in our business information system and in the strategic vendor management system since the both projects came online before the implementation of the Office of the State CIO. But they have been very involved in both projects since the creation of
so
that.
So in
office.
These more recent procurements and stuff, they've been
absolutely
able to look at and help with the RFPs and such. I'm afraid to ask how much we're spending on all these systems because I'll be real depressed. But okay.
Could you talk about the Ed First program? Am I getting it right? I think it's to evaluate some of the educational programs. Am I not reading your question right? I see a lot of blank faces. Good job, Brian. You've had me ask a question that nobody can answer.
Ed First was an IT system that we were going forward with that would address many of these things. Parts of Ed First have been rolled into SOMS because okay. It was only going to be an interim solution. I can't speak to specifically what parts are coming online now versus what will be rolled into SOMS, but we'd be happy to provide that information to the committee.
If you could, and I think if we don't have it, just your implementation plans and when the key timelines are and the dates?
Absolutely. We'd be happy to provide that, too.
I just want to, as part of a question, read part of the auditor's narrative in her report in regard to education. It says, additionally, while corrections budget for its academic and vocational programs totaled more than $208 million in fiscal year 2008-09, it confirmed that its system for assessing, processing, and tracking inmate educational data is extremely inadequate and therefore is unable to determine the success of its programs in reducing the chance that inmates will return to prison. Moreover, corrections lack of a plan for placing teachers in institutions and classes based on inmate needs limits the likelihood that education is being provided to eligible populations in an efficient manner. And some of the folks that you are currently cutting have come to talk to me, and just the idea that we don't know how well we're doing, how successful we are, in relation to the Prison Literacy Act, but then you're also going through, as I understand it, letting a lot of seasoned teachers go, and you're replacing them with a lot of TAs, and people are going to have fewer hours. So could you talk to that, and whether we're concerned about the outcomes for successful for the inmates to be able to get their GED and get out?
Well, yeah, so certainly we're concerned for those outcomes, especially now, again, with the...
Well, if you don't make the teachers available, we can't get the savings
right.
From the credits. So...
Well, and at least as described to me by some of those teachers, some of them have been in your employment for over 20 years who are being laid off, and at least their assertion is they're going to be replaced by people who are applying for jobs. It would strike me that...
Well, I don't know the answer to that question. As to the quote that you asked us to respond to, Unfortunately, it's true. The antiquated systems that have existed, we're the first to admit that we'll be happy to move beyond those. In terms of not being able to staff according to risk or need, that's actually not the case. I do believe that in light of the latest budget cut that occurred with adult programs, that the department has been very strategic under the circumstances to implement that budget cut in a way that did take into account risk and needs and time left to serve and a number of important factors. So, again, I think it's something where we're acknowledging some of our past shortcomings, but also optimistic about the direction where we're going.
Is it true in this field that the lack of vocational training and literacy programs leads to an outcome that there's greater recidivism?
I'm sure that's true.
So it's sort of a self-fulfilling prophecy that we're going in a very bad direction by cutting these programs or not having the available data.
Well, I think what we're doing our best to do under these circumstances is to really be as smart as we possibly can with our resources. And I do believe strongly in the model that we're adopting. I think even with a lot less resources, that we have a good shot of being successful and encountering some of the unavoidable aspects of the budget climate that we're in.
Ms. Howe, a question. Just in your experience, and you look at different departments and agencies, when they don't have good numbers, is it because of resources generally? Is it because of culture, priorities? Are the Department of Corrections particularly challenged in this regard?
Well, we've audited the Department of Corrections for years, and unfortunately, we end up having a lot of the same result year after year after year.
That's a bad outcome.
Certainly, right. Some of it is resource-based, but again, I think, and I'll harken back to the governor's State of the State yesterday, too, setting priorities.
Right.
You've got to, even in a constrained environment, my office is under a tremendous amount of pressure right now, and we have to establish priorities and be very strategic. So with all due respect to the department, I think they can be doing more, should be doing more as far as collecting some of this data. You know, if we're going to have an IT system that's available in 2 years, there's got to be some things they can do in the interim as that system's being developed. Again, I think sharing the nature of the types of things that SOMS system is going to collect, how they're going to use it, what types of analyses they're going to do should be something they should be sharing with the legislature. And so they're educating themselves. But in the meantime, I think there are some things that the department could be doing and should be doing. I mean, I don't have specifics for you, but there is some information based on some of the databases that we looked at when we conducted this audit that our IT staff, in fact, we're doing phase two of this report, really trying to hone down and looking at the three-strike population, because that's another issue that the audit committee asked us to look at. So I think there's some existing information that they could be using. Let's not wait until 2012. Hopefully that system does get up and running by 2012 and it collects the data and they do the types of reports and analyses that they're talking about that would be beneficial. But oftentimes systems end up getting delayed and we may be talking 2014. Who knows? Hopefully not. It's done by 2012 so that there is better information. But typically when we go in and we look at departments, resources are an issue for all state agencies, mm-hmm. absolutely. But our perspective is we know that, so let's establish priorities. Let's be as strategic as we possibly can and identify those areas where we're going to get the most basically bang for the buck or have the most impact as opposed to other issues.
Let's ask you a question, and this is consistent with the governor's State of the State, too. The governor announced that he supported California Forward and its Accountability Act, which will be on the ballot in this year, in November. So the question in that, basically, as I understand it, and I think I understand it fairly well, you will be required to have outcomes And in that instance, it would most likely be, when you do outcomes, it's always a question of getting it right, because I know people who criticize it correctly. It just becomes a marketing tool. It's not real. So if you don't have the right outcomes from when you do a management audit, you can't measure the success. It's just everything's fine. So you're not going to the root causes of the problems. So the question becomes, how do you develop those? Do you develop them from you and the LAO? Or in partnership with the departments, or you let the departments do them? And obviously, intuitively, it would suggest that you need a combination, because departments, some departments, not yours, will just use it as a marketing tool. And this is an experience I've had in local government. So just a question to you is, in terms of implementing these kind of things. And then lastly, the frustrating part is, and I think corrections is a perfect example of this, You by the nature of things, put money in a crisis. You're under all these demands, so you put them there. And it's like the proverbial Dutch boy with his finger in the dike. You want to rush out and stop before the next one comes. So we want to move money from crisis to prevention and intervention, and you can't do that unless you have measurements. So in your mind's eyes, we've talked about this in the committee that Mr. Fuhrer and I and you've come to. It's just sort of how would you do it? Because we were having these discussions both internally and with California Forward.
Right. And as we discussed at the hearing that I attended in L.A., I think performance measures, if that's performance-based budgeting and performance measures, if that's the direction the state is going to go, which is fine, I think the agencies are the ones that should develop initially the performance measures, but I do think you would want either LAO or ourselves, an external independent entity, looking at those measures for reasonableness and commenting on those measures. Because, as I stated at the hearing in Los Angeles, I'll use my office for an example. I could say to the legislature, my office, we're going to issue 20 audits a year. That's one of our outcomes. But if you look at historically, this year we'll issue close to 40 products. Mm-hmm. Most of them audits, some of them summary reports, et cetera. So I think you need to have someone who has the ability to look at what are the measures. And again, as we discussed in the hearing in Los Angeles, you don't want to create 100 performance measures because you're buried in the detail. Mm-hmm. You want to identify, again, what are the priorities, what are the performance measures that we think are important this year or the next couple of years. Let's try to address those, develop good performance measures. And then how are you going to capture that data to determine whether or not you're meeting that measure? Mm-hmm. And then who is going to verify that the information that's being presented as far as these are the outcomes? Would that be the state auditor coming in and doing an audit to verify that the performance measurement data that the department is presenting to the legislature is accurate?
Right.
So I think, as you stated, it would be a combination. I don't think we would have the expertise to say these are the performance measures that the Department of Corrections should have. I think the department should come up with them, and then we could look at it and say, how did you determine these should be your priorities? How did you come up with these performance measures? What historical information did you use to determine that these are the appropriate benchmarks that you want to accomplish in the coming years?
Okay. So. Well, this is extremely important, as Senator Duchenne said. You can't, and having, at Senator Duchenne's suggestion, watched hours of tapes with Senator Machado trying to get to just how do we measure recidivism. Mr. Lewis was very prominent in those hearings. But it does bring me to the conclusion, since Senator Wright isn't here, a quote he frequently uses, if you do what you've always done and expect that you will get what you always got, and apparently this is a situation exactly. Senator Wright would have already said that an hour ago. So just in terms of us having oversight, I think we need your implementation plans, and then maybe we need to not just have hearings but meet regularly for us to understand how it's going, so we're not just following into the same pattern where you come back every year and say we're trying, but we're not getting anywhere.
Certainly. We welcome that. We appreciate the comments by the state auditor. And in closing, unless there are further questions, I'd be happy to answer. I would like to assure the committee that in the interim period, we're not sitting on our heels until 2012 to begin looking at data. What we have right now are pockets of inadequate data. But at the same time, we have a robust system of tracking, and looking at, monitoring, checking compliance with data, and that's our CompStat process. It's a process we're really proud of. It's a process that's been noted in the Little Hoover Commission. It's a process I invite everyone here at the table and part of this committee to come on out and take a look at it, and you'll see, I think, really something which is at the forefront of best practices, something that puts corrections in a leadership position among other California law enforcement agencies. We look forward, obviously, to that being even strengthened with the underlying support of these enterprise systems in the future. But in the meantime, that's robust. It's all 33 institutions, 4 parole regions, 5 missions. CompStat. We have regular meetings. It's a formal process. We'd love to have the state auditor's staff come out if they haven't already.
I'd be happy to.
Thank you.
Is it an acronym?
It's been
abbreviation. Yes.
Yeah. It's been variously defined as comparative statistics or computerized statistics. Either way works. It's both computerized and comparative. It's a way for us to look at apples to apples comparisons across between institutions and parole regions, missions.
All right. Well, Senator Cheney. I'm sorry.
Sorry. I mean, if you're done.
I'm finished. Yes.
Okay. I don't know about CompStat, but where's, I mean, to the extent we're talking about this literacy and these results, I thought we implemented the Compass already, right? We already do this thing of testing people when they come in and trying to figure out what they ought to do, right?
Okay. Right, that's a risk and needs assessment.
A risk and needs assessment, right. Thank you. I knew there was a reason. Compass was the one that came to me, but okay. So we do the risk and needs assessment, but... And then we try to program people, but we're cutting all the programming available to them to meet the Compass. And then we don't have a way of determining if they succeeded in the program. But in the meantime, we're going to try to give them credits. I mean, I'm trying to get the order down of which pieces of that we have in place.
Well, we are beginning a system of tracking completions much more thoroughly than we have in the past, because there is
the credit
completion requirement, you know, that you get credits for completions. So we are moving towards tracking completions, but that's not truly the outcome data that the auditor is speaking about.
Right, that's which different requires, than saying, did you get the ninth grade level of reading out of completing the class, right?
Correct. So we currently track some literacy scores, because we're required to by the federal government, and track literacy gains through the TABE scores. So we do track some literacy data based on that. But
I think it'd show up in there. I mean, just assume I got a little case file on this person that, you know, did a Compass thing and says they read at the sixth grade level and they're going to be out in 3 years and, you know, whatever all that stuff is, semi-not violent, blah, 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 whatever. Then you say, oh, okay, well, we got to put this person in a reading class. But now, under the current cuts, is there a reading class available for them?
Well, one of the things that we have done in the program reduction is try to implement a much more robust system of literacy learning than we had in the past. It's less focused on some of the academic areas, and I see that there's probably some people
that come
up.
It's a triaging issue, right? Okay, well.
So we are trying to focus on literacy learning and implement some different models for literacy than we have in the past.
So it's a priorities question. I get that part. Although now we'll get to the other piece, which is the funding piece. When you're cutting that, I mean, you know, the governor proposed last year to cut all of those programs. We said no. You've cut quite a bit. He did an additional cut in the vetoes, if I recall correctly, that was beyond what the legislature had approved. And in the meantime, and this is one, I don't know that anybody's got this data today, but LAO, somebody out there, as we enter what I presume will be 58 session hearings next week, and try to get a handle on what the assumptions are and why the supposed savings that people hoped for are, at least the LAO and the auditor saying, may not be realized, or I don't know what finance is going to admit or not admit tomorrow. But there are inherent costs in some of the existing implications. The furloughs, The cost of making up for those furloughs, having lost the lawsuit. I'm sorry, I missed the part on how much that lawsuit cost. But I think we need to look at, if we're going to look at cost effectiveness of stuff, the furloughs themselves cost money. Paying back people because you lost the lawsuit costs money. Paying for the attorneys in the lawsuit costs money, both the plaintiffs and the defense attorneys. And so then the and then you're paying overtime because of furloughs. You're paying, you know, I don't know. And then there's another set of cost factors for me that are like, what's the lost opportunity cost of not accepting the settlement that the secretary negotiated with the courts, with Kelso for the courts last year, and that settlement after it was negotiated being rejected? What's the cost of not having the telemedicine stuff online that I think was part of the discussions here? Telemedicine, we're making all the clinics do it. Why on earth would we not be doing that for prisons? I mean, we're making the universities and the clinics do it. Why don't we have a decent system of managed care? If we can be the lowest cost Medi-Cal state in the country, why can't we be the lowest cost prison Medi-Cal state in the country? I mean, I'm missing some of the connectors here that are costing us. The governor says he wants to lower the cost of prisons, and all I've seen for 6 years is escalating costs, partly due to these lost opportunity costs, in my view. Paying overtime because we don't have contracts, paying, you know, the cost of furloughs, which are very expensive in a certain way because you end up paying overtime. I mean, it doesn't work. And getting smart about how we take whatever dollar amount we think is the dollar amount that we ought to spend, let's just, you know, take the governor's number and say that we're only going to spend 8% of our budget on prisons this year, because our budget has been reduced substantially. That 8% would be about $7 billion, and right now we're at about 10, I'm presuming, give or take, because that's where we've been for a few years. So, you know, when the budget was $100 billion, you were under 10%, and that was kind of where we were 3 years ago, but your percentage has gone up. So I'm not dinging on that. I mean, I think the governor's numbers are unrealistic when the revenues drop the way they are. So you kind of got to think about the reason the percentage of prison budget has gone up so much is because the dollar amount hasn't changed, except that the revenue numbers have dropped so low that the percentage has gone up. I mean, that's realistic. So I'm not concerned about that number so much as the fact that we got fewer people, we got all these new reforms, we got these things, we had the opportunity for settlement, we've known the costs of health care were high, we've, you know, been dealing with these lawsuits for years and years and years. And somehow we're still spending, you know, that same $10 billion, and we shouldn't have to be. And it shouldn't be at the cost of those programs that are the most proven to be the most effective in terms of reducing recidivism and therefore future population growth. So how we put those pieces together and figure out where those savings ought to be and who ought to be, I just don't know how we adjust the management to acknowledge that and put the priority on, you know, we go back to one that comes up every year, but putting the priority on the ground rather than on Sacramento. God bless you, too, who do work in Sacramento, and some of you are needed. But I somehow there's a bunch of folks in headquarters, and this has come up with the judicial branch and AOC, and it comes up with UC every year. It's not an unfamiliar theme. But especially in the context of these kinds of operations, how much focus have we got on the ground versus on the top? And, you know, you need people influence systems. You need some management team. I'm not trying to wholesale it, but looking at what are those positions and who ought to be where, I think is of some importance in the immediate if we are to address what I presume will be the governor's new assumptions about lack of meeting the assumptions from last summer. They are not revenue-based assumptions. They are mostly failures of management assumptions. And I think that was clear from the LAO's analysis, and I think it's I don't know where else DOF could go. They're going to have to, if they're assuming a similar number to what the LAO came out with, most of it is from things that have changed that are not just revenue declines. It's not like last year where suddenly we dropped, you know, lost $15 billion in revenues overnight. This is a little more systemic. The drop in revenues from the assumptions last summer are pretty minimal, actually, probably in the neighborhood of $1 billion or less, which in a budget of $80 billion, it's, you know, is not as high as it might be, and so therefore the focus has to be on why are the things that we thought were solutions or savings that we hope to achieve not being realized. And you know, it's a sort of message to the world, but I mean that's going to be the focus for the next couple of weeks in all departments, and yours, the governor highlighted you all yesterday, so now you're stuck. And I think it's important for us to try to get a handle on that, because I just think some of these things that people thought were savings are not really savings. And until we, you know, we had this hearing in the fall, you know, about the Board of Equalization and some other positions where there is a huge cost to the theoretical savings. And that the savings are not savings, that their savings are costs. That it costs $300 million to furlough employees at Board of Equalization because they are not collecting that $300 million in taxes. That it costs millions of dollars to constituents, to residents of the state who are entitled to certain payments, services, whatever, when the people who are supposed to deliver those are told they can't do their job. And those dollars are dollars that circulate in the economy and keep jobs and businesses moving. So there's a huge cost to not only not paying them and not getting their tax money, but there is also a cost to not delivering the payments to a unemployment insurance recipient, to a disability insurance recipient, all of these things which are federal dollars that we're leaving on the table because we aren't delivering them because we're not allowing our workers to do what they were hired to do. So at some point we got to reconcile those before we go much further on this. So it's just sort of a LAO kind of look at that, and you know, in the context of this department, it's just an obvious one. And so I don't know how to think about it. I mean, the fact that we don't have contracts with employees means that savings that could have been realized based on bargaining aren't there, and therefore all our savings are being done in a way that causes lawsuits because they're all illegal. And so it's just it just mounts on itself. And until we get a handle on that, and I go back to I'm still not clear why we rejected the settlement that we negotiated to get ourselves out of the Coleman lawsuit in a way that would have been probably the least expensive way I've seen to get out of that thing in the last 5 years.
Thank you. You feel better?
Always.
I've spoken like somebody who's been chair of budget for a while and understands the institution. Well, thank you all. We look forward to seeing you back. That brings us to public comment. And as the panel leaves, if you'd like to speak under public comment, please come forward. We'd like to keep your comments to about 3 minutes. This is scheduled for 10 minutes, so we've gone over with the panels. We will indulge you to a point. Good afternoon. Welcome.
Good afternoon. My name is Cindy Greer. I am an academic teacher at Valley State Prison for Women in Chowchilla, California. I am one of the few that get to remain a teacher within our prison system. I've loved my job the last 15 years, and it's going to change after the end of this month. The milestones that are going to be giving some credit to the inmates, I welcome that. I question some of the milestones that are going to be given. On the assessments that are given to the inmates, which has been the TABE score for years, you're aware of that, when they come in. And upon the TABE score, if they get to start an ABE1, which is Adult Basic Education Level 1, 0 to 4th grade reading level, they're going to get a week's credit when they pass that. So it's not going to take them very long to learn that, okay, when I get incarcerated, I got to flunk that test. I'm just going to bubble in the bubbles and so I can go into ABE1 and get that week. So we're going to have some issues on these milestones. So we need to be proactive. We need to start looking at those. I'm experienced. I'm speaking of experience. I know how they blow these tests when they need to. I'm concerned in the audit report that our headquarters...
Didn't we also put in, or at least I know we talked about putting in more credit for passing the test than for just sitting in it? I thought we did it that way,
It hasn't been done that way where they get credit for passing a TABE. We'll discipline them if they don't give it their best effort.
No. I thought our credit system said... You know, I've forgotten the numbers, but if you get a week's credit for completing the class, you get 2 weeks credit for passing the test or hitting the high school diploma or something. Didn't we try to?
I haven't seen the milestone list yet. I'm just concerned that from what I've heard.
Remember we talked about
that. The milestone are going to be based upon where they first assess on that tape
right.
when they
no,
come
that
in.
That makes sense.
Come back up.
Yeah, no, it's okay. It's just.
In the field, we've not been able to see those milestones. On the auditor report, I'm concerned with the lack of information that in the field we've given as far as what's called a SPARC report, and of course that's an antonym, but the SPARC report is a TABE test that's giving to those students in school. They are those receiving services. The SPARC report is done quarterly. It is given to the headquarters. It is done for every institution. And it marks their growth per the TABE test, and it's the whole battery. It's reading, it's math, it's language, it's spelling. And none of that's mentioned in that report to show the gains that we're getting
with, on an individual basis.
On an individual basis, those in school receiving services. We were devastated as teachers not to show how the WEA funds had been increased per the CASAS testing. The SPARC was not included. The attendance per institution was not shown. All these things are in that wonderful, glorious ComStat report they're talking about, or they're reported and they're not given in this audit report. So we were very devastated as the employees. We have GEDs that are documented. We have diplomas, vote completions, all these things. The missing component is that when they get out, we are not tracking for recidivism.
Right.
I have been an employee and asking for this as a very active activist. When will you start checking our records? When will you start allowing us? IYO, the Incarcerated Youth Offender Program that is federally funded, has the lowest recidivism rates. They do an outstanding job, and yet that is our state teachers delivering those services, and those numbers are not included. Why are not we trying to model the IYO program? Mm-hmm. As a high school diploma teacher, I take my students, and as I get them near graduation, I talk with my IYO instructor. I get them right in their program, and we have had successes of my graduates going to her program so that we can start to get some tracking. Never reported. Never reported. If we could just reduce overtime 25%, medical, COs, we would not be facing these cuts that we're looking at. So we're going to remain custody. We're going to have so-called public safety. I'm going to be concerned for my own public safety with these cuts, because now the teachers are looking at, out of 170,000 incarcerated, there's going to be an academic teacher of about one per 377 inmates and about a vocational instructor about one out of every 1,200. But the numbers are going to show that we're touching them. Please be careful of the numbers that are going to be reported to you. I'm going to have inmates for 3.5 hours once a week, but yet it's going to show that they have a week of instruction, because I'm going to be giving them packets and homework to do. Watch your numbers. We have offered savings of working a 184-day year versus 220. I'd be willing to take that pay cut to keep more of my experienced colleagues employed. This is before we knew about these new models. Now we have civil service teaching assistants that are going to be hired, 335 of them. After
They're hiring new people?
Yes,
sorry,
ma'am.
While you're furloughing and paying overtime?
Yes, ma'am. 335 teaching assistants at $12 an
hour. Who authorized those positions? This legislature didn't.
Mr. Lewis, would you like
to... We ain't authorizing new positions. This is kind of second salvo of the morning for anybody who hasn't heard that speech last year. We're not authorizing new positions, especially when you're doing furloughs.
Well, the legislature took an unallocated cut to programming. They did not take any positions. So one of the alternatives is to adjust what a position is for to get more bang for your buck. Certainly a teaching assistant is significantly less than a teacher, so you're able to hire more people. But our positions will still be a net reduction in the total number of positions in the department for the cut.
We're going to have to poke at that one a little more.
Thank you. I'd appreciate your help in that. Mm-hmm. After we found out about these 335 positions, we asked from our activism, SEIU asked from our, could we forget the TAs who are going to come in inexperienced? Could we
keep teachers and go to a model that is 27 in the morning and 27 in the afternoon, so at least I would be touching the same group of students 5 days a week. You have the furloughs, you have holidays, these models that they're going to be seeing students once a week. If you have a lockdown or they have a priority docket to go to another department, you're not going to see them for weeks. We have no continuity. It is not, they're selling us that these models are based on adult education. Well, it's in a real world. We're not in a real world in the prison system. There's so many reasons they aren't going to be able to come to class. So I'd be glad to talk to you at any time and be at your services to let you know they're not research-based per the population we deal with. I don't know where else to go unless you want to hear a little bit about the models. They're horrible. I'm going to be supervising 135 inmates. And that those models go up to 190, and that's with the help of one or two teaching assistants. So,
what Senator Cheney's mentioning to me is, Cindy, if you could give us those in writing, so we have them.
I can fax you a copy of them.
You can email us both. We'd like to see those.
You betcha. These numbers.
I was just going to point out how many of the few teachers left are devoted to testing.
Almost half of our teachers that are left are going to be devoted strictly to assessment in the reception centers, the tape testing,
the K-12.
And the CASA. So we're going to be basing more on assessment than we are in instruction. So we will get you those models. We have copies of them. We'll send attachments to your offices because they're deplorable in our eyes. And we have yet to sit at the bargaining table, and that's coming up. They're going to schedule meetings starting today. But we're being told in the field that the OCE's direction is it will be in place by March. So I don't know what good it's going to do to try to bargain them. But we're gonna bargain. We're going to go through our phases. I don't have anything else. Thank you for your time. I really appreciate it, and I am available.
Thank you, Ms. Greer. Thanks for coming, and thanks for your time yesterday with me.
I'm John Kern. I've testified a few times before, but at heart, basically, I'm still just a gardener, so pardon me if I get a little bit disorganized, and I'll try not to go too long. Thank you for your support and your analysis, Senator DuCheney, and thanks to the State Auditor for bringing to light some of the lousy work we've been doing on data keeping and trying to create some way to do this business of incarcerating people by the numbers. The only number that counts in corrections is whether you have all your inmates where they're supposed to be at the end of a shift, and that's about it. All the rest of the numbers are a poor attempt to try to capture a human tragedy, the impact of a victimization, loss of life, injustice or justice done, and all the rest, everything from the drama from prison movies to the actual banality and boredom of sort of everyday life in a prison and the face of evil. I've been doing this for 25 years, and I thought that I would make my attempt at the kind of correctional math that I look at. When I started the job at Soledad Prison teaching criminals how to be landscapers, I felt immediately that I was being ineffective, and I really felt almost a duty to quit my job. Apparently, I don't know how to do this. It's not working, or they don't send me the right students, or I don't know what's wrong with the formula, but we don't seem to be focusing on the outcomes. And a colleague took me aside and said, look, at that time, 1984, we spent probably around $30,000 a year per inmate, 35, I don't know. And my salary was proportionately less, so the math probably still works. But he pointed out that if I do anything in my interactions with my students to keep one or two guys from coming back to prison, or even just delay their return to prison for a year or two, I have paid my salary. And from that basic low standard, I went forward and have been teaching landscaping ever since, until my last day, which is coming up in about 2 weeks. The department has either found out that I'm a fraud, or they have figured out that what I do is not worth it. And I don't know if they're right or not. But I know that I've been given credit by various inmates who've contacted me for saving their lives. And I usually turn it back on them and say, no, I gave you a resource, and you saved your own life. And on behalf of all the taxpayers and myself,
grateful.
Thank you for doing that. And spread the word and, you know, make it happen among others. But so, anyway, back to some specifics on vocational training. We're also being cut tremendously. The academic side and the vocational side of education are going away to a large degree, including a series of trades that have been chosen for complete elimination based on spurious evidence. The question we have is if the department has the ability to determine the connection between participation in a program and recidivism reduction or increase, then they ought to be doing that. But in my 25 years, I haven't noticed any interest, honestly, despite some very rough guides, rough technologies being available. There's an offender information system that may be soon to go out the window, I don't know, and be replaced by some new IT system. But it's not that hard to figure out if an inmate who paroled succeeded on parole, discharged his parole, or violated his parole. And that happens within 13 months to maybe a couple of years out. Whether you can tie an inmate's success or ability to discharge parole to the fact that he spent some time in John Kern's class, I don't know. But at least statistically, you could count those numbers up. The inability of the department to assess our success in our programs. As an educator, I'm used to being judged by whether I teach people new skills. I don't know of any other educators whose standard is also to keep people from committing crimes and or getting caught for committing crimes. So as educators, Cindy and the rest of us can easily demonstrate our success. Our learning gains in reading, our learning gains in math, in all the various literacy components, in various vocational saleable skills. We document that stuff all day long. We produce so much paperwork and so many reports that when the state auditor's report came out indicating that the department itself was admitting it was unable to track the data, there was a howl of protest up and down the state from teachers who had so much of their instructional time taken from them for producing all this data. Where did it go was the question everybody asked. And since I come to Sacramento once in a while, they wanted me to find it. So I don't know where it all is. It's sitting in a file somewhere.
Came to the wrong place.
Right, but it didn't turn into anything. Meanwhile, it's implied that somehow we're not certifying inmates for on the vocational side. How do we measure skills? Well, we measure them ourselves as instructors, but also we participate, the vocational programs participate in quite a range of industry certifications. So my students, you don't have to take my word for it that they now qualified for a pesticide applicator's license as issued by the Department of Pesticide Regulation. You can ask the DPR, because on a good day, we managed to get that agency in and certify our inmates. At the prison at Solano, we have a high success rate, a huge success rate. A teacher volunteered to double the size of his class so that he could meet the minimum quorum required to have that department issue the exam, and luckily by Solano being close enough to Sacramento, he can conduct those exams on a regular basis, and he has a last time around over 90% pass rate for the QAC, Qualified Applicator Certificate, and that's just one example from my trade. The American Welding Society certifies welding students. The OPISA certifies small engine repair students. Fabricare even is involved, used to be in the certification of dry cleaning students. Students are getting EPA certification for refrigerant disposal, Freon and all that. Of course, automotive is well known with the ASE program, issuing ASE certificates right and left. It goes on and on. In the printing and graphic arts, there's a print ed. Microsoft is certifying students in the office services. So the fact that the department is unable to show the success of the educational programs, vocational or academic, is quite mysterious to those of us that, as you said, are on the ground, in the field, doing the work every day, basing our self-worth on that formula I worked out about correctional math. If I can save one or two out of my class of 27 or 54 or 200, I mean, I don't care what size my class is going to be. There's 100 ways to teach horticulture. I'm willing to do any one of them that the department wants me to do. but apparently none of them are going to work, and I'm not going to work for them anymore in a few more days for some amazing budgetary reason.
Thanks, John.
Yeah.
Anyone else for public comment? Well, John, hopefully some miracle will come about and you'll be able to continue to do the work you've done so well for so many years. To you and Cindy, thanks for the time, and we'll do our best. You've really, I think, been helpful. I know for me at least, and I think for Senator Duchenne as well. So we need to keep in touch.
You're going to work on that miracle?
I'd like to find one-tenth of a miracle right now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all. We're adjourned.